Hello there, welcome back to Becca Ballistics. Today's gun is a special one. It's a Lange Pisole 08, colloquially known as the Artillery Luger, marked 1917. It's the longest barreled version of the Luger pistols, with its 8-inch barrel and only so used in World War I. I'll tell you more about its features later on. This gun was found together with the two Sten guns I covered in my very first video on this series about a year ago. The gun is in fair condition, but there are a few things I need to take care of to get this thing back in working order. First of all, this gun was found exactly in this configuration. The side plate is in its place, but the disassembly lever is not fully in, which means it can't rotate. Also, the serial number on the plate, 43, is different from that of the rest of the gun, ending in 93, so somebody definitely messed up with this thing. Let's get it apart and give it a closer look. Notice how the inside surfaces are not black. This was common on rust-blued guns like this one, since the chemicals were applied by swabbing instead of dipping, and only the outer surfaces were swabbed, leaving the insides white. What came as a less expected and appreciated surprise is that the bolt had the firing pin, spring and spring guide missing. I can't know for sure what happened there, but I can speculate somebody might have wanted to keep the gun for a rainy day, but rendered it harmless in case somebody accidentally came across it. In any case, we ordered a spare set, which is the one you see here, and I'll take the occasion to give you a heads up about fake spares. You see, German guns are notable for having the last two digits of the serial number stamped on the majority of parts. This helped the armourer avoid mismatching parts from different guns, and made sense because back then manufacturing processes were not as consistent as today's, and not all parts were fully interchangeable. Today, a specimen where all the parts have matching serial numbers is much more valuable than a mismatching one, and a lot of fakes are circulating. If you look closely at the light reflection, you'll see this part has been ground slightly to remove the left part of a 0 and turn the other half into a 9. It's unfortunately a widespread trick, but now you know what to look for to avoid it. Those of you that have been following me for a while know that I do my best at providing genuine educational content, which is the reason my videos are voiced over instead of plain ASMR. Firearms are a touchy topic that not many are comfortable with, so there's little mainstream educational content about them, resulting in widespread ignorance, which can be exploited against us all. Just give me a minute to explain. Let me show you a news story on Ground News website. Elon Musk tweets photo of gun on bedside table and people are concerned, states one outlet. A different one claims Elon Musk's bedside table is even more terrifying than you'd expect. Now, do you want to see what that picture really showed? Just look at it. Do you see a real gun? The one in the background is a flintlock replica, most likely non-firing, about as threatening as a rolling pin in any case, and the other is a very obvious plastic toy. Yet many news outlets are depicting a completely different image, either for grabbing clicks or political reasons. Just let me turn on Ground News' political bias filter to make sure. Look at how most left-wing sources let the reader think the guns are real, while right-wing ones highlight how the objects portrayed were just props, clearly showing the political bias of sources at play. Ground News is a great tool in our deceitful media world. Both a website and an app, it aggregates tens of thousands of sources around the globe so that you can compare how the same story is covered by each, also giving them an independent factuality ranking, as well as highlighting the presence of any political or national bias, making it much easier to gather reliable information. Ground News is one of the sponsors that I'm most proud of, and I suggest you try it out for free at ground.news/backyard or subscribe to get unlimited access for a much more transparent news experience. Anyway, most of the original finish is still present and I want to save it. The first thing I'm going to do is place the parts into the ultrasonic cleaner loaded with a warm alkaline detergent so that it won't harm the bluing. This will get rid of all the greasy residues and generic dirt. I then have to get rid of the rust spots. I can't do it chemically, otherwise bluing would be dissolved as well. So I'll do a quick boil in water instead. If there's any convertible rust, it will be transformed into additional bluing, and the excess will detach from the surface. On the other hand, this won't do much of anything to the harder lumps that you see over the surface, so we'll have to remove them mechanically with steel wool and brush. Of course, since I'm saving the original finish, I'm not going to do any sanding. After a lot of elbow grease, here's what I'm left with. The bluing doesn't look very dark because there's no oil, but most of it is still in its place, with the exception of a few areas. To make it more homogeneous, I'm still applying a couple passes of rust bluing. I've shown how to do this many times in my previous videos, and I'm working on an in-depth guide right now, so I'm going over it very quickly, and here's the result. What I'm instead going to do is focusing on restoring the finish of those parts that were originally coloured. I like to bring guns as close as possible to how they looked when they were made, and in this case a lot of steel parts were neither black nor white. The trigger, magazine release, ejector, safety and disassembly levers were in fact straw coloured, while two small leaf springs were blue. Have you ever asked yourself how these parts are coloured? They are clearly not painted, and back in 1917, they certainly didn't have fancy inorganic coating processes. Those colours are produced simply through iron oxidation, but if you look at a chemistry book, you'll see there is no blue iron oxide, and even though there's a yellow one, you can't really get a coating made out of it. In fact, the fancy colours we're soon going to recreate do not come from any substance, but instead from a physical phenomenon called thin film interference. In a nutshell, if we get a thin film of oxide to form on steel, for example by heating it, in the reflected light you'll get some specific colours to be highlighted depending on the thickness of the film. As the thickness increases from zero, you'll first see a light yellow colour that progressively changes into a darker and darker straw before quickly turning to a deep purple and finally blue. There are other shades that can form, like green, but we don't see them on steel. You can instead see them form on other metals, like titanium and bismuth. Anyway, on steel, the thickness of the oxide, and therefore the colour, is strictly dependent on temperature. For this reason, the colour I just described are also known as temper colours. Since each colour corresponds to a specific temperature, the metalsmith can tell when he's reached the temper he needs just by looking at the colour. For a simple, small part like a leaf spring, resting on a hot plate is good enough, but on larger, more intricate parts, you'll never be able to get a uniform temperature, which means the colour won't be uniform too. One way around this is to use a bath of molten nitrate salts that will act not only as the heating media, but also as the source of oxygen. In this case I'm using a 50-50 mix of potassium nitrate and sodium nitrite. The exact mixture doesn't matter as long as it's molten at the temperature you need, but the presence of nitrite, although poisonous, renders the process quicker and more reliable. Keep in mind, the liquid you see is entirely made up of molten salts. There is no water involved, and as you can imagine, it's quite a dangerous process. Once dipped, the parts will start going through the temper colours, and unless you have a perfect temperature control, which I clearly don't, you'll have to keep an eye on it. Once you've reached the desired colour, the part is dipped in water, dried and oiled. In a rough setup like mine, it's easy to overshoot and get one of the next temper colours. In this instance, I was going for straw, but got a purple instead. When this happens, the best thing to do is simply dipping the part in dilute hydrochloric acid, and that will quickly dissolve the oxide layer, allowing the process to be carried out again. Once I was satisfied with the result, I oiled everything and all the metal parts are ready for reassembly. As for the grips, there's another interesting thing going on with them. It's obvious that the right one is darker than the left one. In this specific case, one is matching the serial number of the gun and the other is matching that of the sight plate, so it looks like two different pistols were merged into one, and this could explain the colour difference. However, it's kind of a common occurrence on military pistols with wooden grips to find the right darker than the left one, and I'm not exactly sure why, although I have a few theories. My original reasoning was that when the gun is in the holster, the right side of it is more exposed to the elements and to sunlight, which is known for darkening oil finishes. However, in one instance I stripped the finish down completely and the wood underneath was still bearing the colour difference between left and right grip, and darker timbers, like this walnut, actually tend to get lighter with sunlight, not darker. A viewer suggested that maybe what darkened the right grip were impurities carried by the right hand holding the weapon, and that could make sense since there are a lot of substances that can cause wood tannins to darken. If any of you has a better explanation, please comment it down below. In any case, that's part of the gun's history, so I leave it like that. I try telling apart the signs left by use and those left by neglect, and only save the former. So I'm just cleaning the checkering with a brush and applying some boiled linseed oil. And here's the final result. But will it work? Since the gun was found without one, I took a spare original magazine from our warehouse, still bearing its price tag. On the first shots, the gun actually jammed quite often, but I'm not worried about that. Whenever you reblue a firearm, it's like moving parts need to break in again, and you can even feel the mechanics move more freely after a few shots. We shot over 100 rounds with it, and by the end of that, the gun was working perfectly fine. The accuracy was, on the other hand, a bit disappointing, and I'm pretty sure that has to do with the barrel. I'm not sure it shows well on camera, but this bore is in very poor condition. There are no major deep pits that could pose a safety issue, but the whole inside surface is very porous and most of the rifling appears to be worn out. And don't leave just yet, there's still a lot I want to tell you. First of all, look at the rear sight, which you won't find on any other Luger. It's a beautifully made ram sight, adjustable up to 800 meters, but look at the hinge pin on both sides of the barrel. Notice how it's tilted, and that was on purpose, so that as you adjust the elevation, the rear sight not only moves up, but also to the left, compensating for the spin-induced drift of the bullet. As if the problem of shooting a 9mm gun at 800 meters of distance was the spin drift. Just to give you some sense of perspective, this range is only 50 meters long, and for a handgun it's already considered a long shot, quite literally. 800 meters is 16 times as far, and at such a distance, if the 9mm bullet was to be fired horizontally, it would drop 45 meters. In other words, to hit a target at ground level, you'd need to fire from the 13th floor of a building. Of course, instead of doing that, we tilt the barrel upwards when firing at longer distances, and that's the whole point of the adjustable rear sight. It forces you to tilt the barrel of the required angle to hit the target at a specified distance. But still, in our case, the bullet path would be so curved that if your target was just 10 meters beyond the 800 meters mark, you'd be missing the aimed spot by almost a meter. But the role this gun was designed to fulfill was in fact close combat, acting as what we'd nowadays call a pistol caliber carbine. And the need for this kind of weapon was felt for the first time by artillery units, hence the nickname Artillery Luger, that needed a more practical weapon than a full power rifle for defending themselves. Compact size and high rate of fire were the basic requirements, and that's what the Artillery Luger was designed to offer, with its production starting in 1914 and ending in 1918. The majority of samples were actually made in 1917, just like the one we just refinished. Keep in mind that before 1918, that is for practically the whole duration of World War I, no practical shorter fired automatic weapon was fielded. And the Artillery Luger could, in fact, be fired from the shoulder. Each gun was provided with a holster that also acted as a stock, engaging the bottom of the pistol frame so that the assembled unit would behave more like a carbine than a pistol. You can see a replica stock holster combination fitted to the pistol in our test shoot at the range, and we used that to test the accuracy of the weapon. At 50 meters we got bullet holes scattered all over the target, with some not even hitting it at all. We decided to repeat the test at 25 meters, and this is what we got. Even though all of the rounds did hit the target, the grouping was far from great, and most importantly, some flyers ended up quite far from the main group, and on them we can appreciate a clear sign of insufficient gyroscopic stability of the bullet. Look at how the black mark left by these shots is non-symmetric. It means the bullet was flying at an angle when it went through the paper, as it was wobbling because of insufficient gyroscopic effect. This is unfortunately the typical target pattern of a worn-out barrel. Once again, a huge thanks goes to my patrons, which as usual are all listed here. Thank you all for watching, subscribe if you'd like to see more, and I'll see you next time. Bye.